For a session sponsored by Accenture, please welcome Managing Director of Aviation Accenture, Jonathan Keane, in discussion with Skift, Founder and Chief Executive Officer, Rafat Ali.
Thank you, Jonathan. So, how's the morning been so far? Good? Fascinating sessions, right? That every session I'm saying, like, how can we top this? Such good interviews, all of them. So thank you for listening. Thank you for being here. Thank you, Jonathan, for being here. So we're excited to be working with Accenture on many initiatives across all parts of the travel industry. Jonathan heads the global head of aviation for Accenture, which means that his life is spent on airplanes literally at all times.
Absolutely.
I'm going to ask a question that I don't know the terminology for. What level are you at, on these planes?
About 35,000 feet mainly.
35,000 feet. Yeah. No, I was saying like, what, well, Delta,
I knew,
Platinum,
I knew the question.
I'm not an av geek. I'm not Brian. I don't know anything about planes. If you put two planes in front of me, I wouldn't be able to tell Airbus versus Boeing. Like, I'm that bad. Luckily, I don't write about airlines. There's a video that Jonathan showed me backstage that I think is really interesting that I want all of you to see. So can we play the video?
Today, your customer expects you to know where they are, what they want, and how to find it. Meeting these demands takes a new kind of travel company. One that can provide adventures in real time. What is real-time travel? It's staying connected to the customer every step of the way, keeping on track even when they're off-road. It's delighting travelers with new experiences, amplifying every moment to make it memorable and personal. It's earning loyalty by being in the right place at the right time. Letting customers lead by giving them the tools they need. But to provide real-time experiences, your business has to work in milliseconds, not minutes. Becoming so agile, you can travel with the customer, no matter where they're headed. It's time to focus on flexibility, so you can take any shape the market requires. It's time to equip your workforce with the right tools to stay connected. It's time to embrace new IT, so you can sense and respond to your customers' needs. It's time to go real time. Accenture Travel, adventures in real time.
All right, thank you for that. So one of the things, so we as a company, we turned 5 years old about a month and a half ago. I think many of you, I mentioned this yesterday as well. One of my biggest things now is thinking about the company long term, which yep. We have the luxury now to think long term, which is an amazing position to be in. For the next 5 years, that's a big thing in my head. Yep. One of the things that I'm very worried about is we were the underdogs that everybody rooted for. We're not that anymore. How do we stay curious? How do we continue to have vitality in the business? Obviously, we're a tiny company compared to the giant companies that you work for. This is a challenge that's magnified 1,000x in the giant companies that you work for in the travel industry, in an industry as complex as airlines. You have done a bunch of research. This is the first time I think we're seeing it. It's the brand new research on living business. You've done. Previously done research on the retail side in it. Now you're doing it in travel. You've spoken to, I think, hundreds of executives in the travel industry. What do you mean by a living business?
It's an interesting point that you bring up. We've just completed this research. We've had the chance to speak to about 120 senior executives, CEOs, C-level executives around the world, just to get their impressions. And I think what you've just outlined there is very similar as a challenge, whether it's a small company that's just been around or a very established company. I was looking at some reports the other day to say that something like 50% of the Fortune 500 from about 2003, 2004 are still in existence. the speed of change that we are going through now and the challenges that all businesses face, large or small, are really, really quite significant. And the way that the research that we've done has kind of played this out sort of talks to two things and two phenomena in terms of ways in which we think about the challenges that businesses face. And they're being attacked, if I can use that word, from two different angles. They're being attacked by what we call the ants. And these ants are those people that are crawling all over their businesses, trying to take some of their share, trying to differentiate and distribute and really disrupt the industry. And then you've got these wolves, on the other hand, these big organizations that are really coming in to try to eat that lunch. And you know, the same is in retail, as you said, where we've done this research, and the same is very, very
I think we
true.
All know who the wolf in retail is.
The same's true, you could argue, in travel as well. I mean, if you think, I'm lucky to meet many of the startups here over the last day or so, an amazing collection of people who are, you know, working as hard as they can to break into these businesses and into this industry. But then the wolves as well. And all of that leads to your point, Rafa, in terms of some of the research that we've done, that despite the fact that we hear some fantastic stories in the industry about growth, growth is hard. Growth is really, really hard.
And I lost my hair as a result of it.
Well, I wasn't going to say anything, but now you've brought it up. It's hard. And what we found in this research, which we've got most of it back, but we'll publish it in a few weeks' time for the remainder of it, there's actually a really big disconnect between the CEO of an organization that we've spoken to in travel, in all these companies around the world, and their leadership team, which to us is a very interesting phenomenon. Oh. So the CEO is saying, 91% of those CEOs that they've interviewed have said they fundamentally need to reinvent their business to ensure they get after this growth. But actually, their teams that support them, only about two-thirds of them think they need to reinvent the business. Hmm. To see that difference is really quite striking.
And what do you attribute that to?
I think that the CEOs are acutely aware of the pressures that they're being placed by their boards, by their shareholders, and maybe some of the senior teams are somewhat insulated from that today. But all of these things tend themselves to the fact that you actually need to do some really fundamental things to make sure you can cope and adopt these very difficult challenges of growth when technology is moving so fast. Customers are expecting and experiencing things so different from other industries that they now expect it to be the case in travel.
Give me an example of what you're talking about from an airline, because that's the world you live in so much, of this disconnect that you're seeing. You may not have to name the airline, but the disconnect you're seeing.
Well, we were just saying backstage, I mean, one of the things that's come out of this research that we've talked to is around what we're calling hyper-relevance. And in a world, you know, I remember American a couple of years ago coming out saying that, you know, about 50% of their revenue comes from customers that only travel once a year. And we're talking about, you know, really distinct new customers that you're trying to attract. How can you be hyper-relevant to those kind of customers? So the airlines that have got very clear products, very clear propositions that are end-to-end and really exhibit the full customer experience of doing well. You know, listening to Arnie this morning about the hotel business, you know, having 30 brands allows you to be really hyper-relevant. You won't get free consulting from Accenture very often, but I'll put a slide up just to explain it. I mean, what we're talking about in terms of hyper-relevance has a whole set of things which many airlines are doing well at. Some of the attributes, you know, moving away from kind of the four P's that we would remember from going up in business school to a world where we recognize that to be really hyper-relevant, the airlines and the hotel companies need to demonstrate a whole set of new attributes that they maybe haven't done before. They need to exhibit things where their customers are proud to be part of that group. They need to exhibit those things where, you know, that business is being formed in partnerships, hearing, you know, Ed talk about what Delta are doing in terms of partnerships. All those things means that the only way that a customer can really engage with business and our business can engage with them is being really hyper-relevant. As we all experience, you know, every time you go onto a website or every time you go to a call center at some airlines, you're treated as an anonymous customer. I mean, I'm amazed still in a world that lives in a legacy technology place for some reasons that we still refer to customers by a PNR, which is the original hard disk reference on a booking from a system that was built 40 years ago. You know, how do we create that hyper-relevant organization to ensure that not only can be relevant to our customers, but listening to Ed as well this morning, how can we be very relevant to our colleagues? Because other research that we've done recently says that there's a huge amount of value clearly in digital from a customer perspective.
Right.
But to come back to your question about from an airline perspective, we think most airlines are leaving significant value on the table when it comes to actually understanding the value from digital in a colleague environment. and all these things, if you can get that experience right of how you engage your new employees, how you treat them when they're there, they will deliver a hyper-relevant experience to your end consumer, which then will come back to Ed's point around differentiating the product and the experience that the customers have.
Yeah, and you mentioned the vitality of a business. Explain what that means, and I don't know if
it's exactly that. I mean, I think to this research that we've been doing, it all talks about how do you create a living business. I mean, gone are those days where you would set up a project, you'd take 6 months to get the requirements, you'd take 6 months to build the system. You know, those days are gone.
At that time, Amazon has 100 warehouses built.
Technology is just moving so fast, and what we're saying is to be a living business, you need to embody a whole series of really key attributes to ensure that you can succeed in a world where growth is proving that elusive and that hard to achieve. And a few of the things that we've said in there are about how do you infuse a culture. I mean, Arnie talked about it, Ed talked about it, Chris and Setter talked about it yesterday. How do you infuse a culture within an organization which means that people feel empowered and want to succeed? And if I look at internet startups, getting after a challenge, they would probably set three teams on a challenge, and then the first person gets there will obviously be will drive that. In an airline world or a hotel world, there aren't many examples where you can say that they would set three teams off a challenge. So having that kind of culture that you are creating this living business idea is really key. The idea that you will prototype more. We worked, everyone talks about chatbots. We worked with Avianca recently on a chatbot, which from concept, from the idea of doing it through to publicly available was 6 weeks. You know, those kind of things are the world that we now live in. And there's a whole range of examples. Jared from my colleague from Accenture Interactive yesterday talked about the need for, making kind of person out of personalization, and the stuff that we've been doing at Melia, for example, where we've driven 30% improvement in direct traffic, 30% improvement in conversion on sites, all through this hyper-relevance and creating a culture within the organization, which means you can prototype fast, you can build an ecosystem that allows you to bring different technologies into the place, and allows you to target people in a way in which our experience, clients, airlines, hotels, travel companies haven't been able to do before.
Yeah, and so, the Avianca thing, talk a little bit about that. Chatbots is a thing that obviously all hotels, airlines, every travel business is thinking about. We've talked about it a bunch over the last couple of days. I saw the announcement when it came out. We wanted you to be the official chatbot of the forum. It didn't come together, but we wanted Accenture to be the official chatbot for the Skift Global Forum. But is it moving beyond customer service at this point?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, we've used a whole lot of terminology, which we would have used different terminology 3 years ago. We'll use different terminology about technology in 3 years' time. We can talk blockchain, we can talk AI, we can talk chatbots. Fundamentally, from our perspective, and the research is backing this up, unless you create what we're calling a living business, unless you actually create that culture, you create the environment, you don't, as Jared says yesterday, you don't show your organization structure through the experience. Unless you do that, a lot of these technologies are interesting things that we can pilot, but they're not going to make a difference. So the Avianca chatbot is a fantastic thing, and we've done some great other chatbots for other clients that we can't talk about. But what it's done is not necessarily what people would have looked at the business case 3 years ago, which was how many people would we save by doing this. What it's doing is freeing up valuable resource that can then have that hyper-relevant conversation and engagement with the end customer, because they're not dealing with where's the toilet, where do I check in? Those questions are being dealt with through chatbots. And actually, even to the extent that we're talking to a number of clients now where chatbots is seen as a kind of B2C proposition, we're actually seeing it as relevant in a B2B proposition that we are informing and empowering our colleagues that might not know everything about the product or experience, but why not use that technology
for
that
giant companies that,
to support you having that conversation with your colleague who then can have the conversation with the customer. And so all these things, the living business concept is one that's, I think, really, really impactful, because we can all be obsessed and all spend a lot of time and a lot of money building some technology solutions. The only thing I know is that the technology solution we build now will be out of date in 3 years' time. And so fundamentally, you need to create that organizational entity, those dynamic teams, that culture, which means that people can succeed. And the research, as I said, will publish the remainder of it in the coming weeks, which backs this up. But unless you get that differentiated view of how you run your businesses, all these things could just be kind of new toys for people to play with.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that was fascinating. Thank you.
Thank you very much.